All right, so let's get started here. Today is June 16th. It's Tupac's birthday.
That's a good thing.
I listened to a lot of Tupac on the radio today. It's like 10:15 at night. We're in Los Angeles, California. I'm Scott Marceau. This is Kevin Connors.
Kevin Connors.
So let's just start at the top here. Introduce yourself.
Kevin Connors, I don't know. I'm a photographer. I just do what I want to do every day. Lucky enough to be able to shoot photos with my friends.
Where did this all start?
I grew up in Baltimore, and then my dad ended up taking a job in Vegas when I was like 19. So it was kind of one of those things, like you either stay in Baltimore and just keep working at this bike shop, making $6.50, $7 an hour as a mechanic. And at the time, I don't know, in the back of your head when you ride BMX and just if you're in the bike industry in general, like I'd already been at that shop for 5 years. So I was like, well, if I want to do anything in the BMX industry, I need to move eventually.
Shop, yeah.
I don't have a choice. You know, there's only so much in Baltimore that you can do. So anyway, I moved to Vegas with them, ran a chain of stores, oversaw one, and then ended up overseeing like a regional chain of stores that sold mountain bikes and road bikes. Then luckily enough, a good friend of mine, Mike Russell, who's still in the bike industry in the sales end of things, I met him, came into the shop doing sales stuff, and he realized I rode BMX, and he's just an intelligent sales rep and knows, like, if you meet the kid in the shop that actually rides BMX and you're selling BMX bikes, you need to be his friend.
Yep.
Me and him became good friends, and he just kept for like 2 years, oh, I'm getting you a job at Harl. I'm getting you a job at Harl. You need to do sales. I mean, you need to sell. Is this amount of money? And like, never really happened. So anyway, long story short, I originally moved to Carlsbad to work with him at Felt, which is now just a full-blown road bike company, my understanding. At the time, it was pretty cool because it was like, you know, I'm just doing sales, but I still shot photos. So to me, it was like, okay, well, I'm in California now because I kind of started shooting in Vegas, I guess, to backtrack a little bit.
Yeah.
I broke my jaw in Vegas. The whole time, my dad had always had an old Pentax. I knew how to use it. Like, I could take an evenly exposed photo, no issues. So I broke my jaw, ordered a shitty fisheye off eBay, and started shooting a lot.
Nice.
And then from there, I was lucky enough, I got a photo in a Truvative catalog, which is a mountain bike company that makes cranks, old friend, Jack Johnson, who, I don't know, it was like an old can-can photo, and it was a horrible photo with like one flash at 285 at 60th of a second. Like, and I remember like my friend Dylan, who worked at the company, he's like, you don't care if I doctor this up? I'm like, nah, dude, do whatever you have to do. Like at that point, I'm just like, amazed that somebody wanted a photo, you know?
Yeah.
And so then when I moved, I was working at Felt for a couple months before getting hired. I actually ended up leaving there and getting hired at Haro. And that's kind of when everything changed. I was doing sales at the time, but I was best friends with Joe Riley, Matt Kolish, all those dudes. I'd already met Harrington. Like, so I was already friends with the whole premium team and riding a premium and hanging out with them every day. Luckily enough, the designer there at the time, Pete Demos, came to my desk one day asking, like, oh, I heard you rode. We're going to go ride the skate park. And he's like, oh, wait, you shoot photos? And it was just like at the time, I think I had a bunch of just bullshit, like 35mm black and whites I had printed up.
Yeah.
Because I did take one class. So I'd print up all these black and whites. So anyway, he saw them and he's like, oh, you shoot photos, blah, blah, blah. He's like, then why the hell, like, why am I going to the Claremont contest this weekend? I'm like, what do you mean? Like, why are you going? He's like, well, the team's going to be there. I was going to shoot a couple photos, you know, for whatever. And he's like, well, why don't you just go? And he's like, what do you shoot with? And I showed him my camera, like this Pentax. And he was like, okay, cool. Well, and he just handed me a box of 100 slide film.
Damn.
And was like, here's another 285. He was like, this is how it works. You plug the fucking, it was the optical slave at the time.
Oh,
like the shitty Hein ones. Like if you didn't have the $100 one, it was never going to fire. So anyway, he gave me one of those, and it was just, like, funny because I brought the rolls back, and he was like, all right, cool. Like, talk to whoever was my higher-up, and was like, we're going to dip and go to the photo lab. And at that point, it was, like, real weird because here's this designer dude taking away from the bread and butter, the sales of the company.
Yeah.
So he kind of set me down a weird path as far as, like, Haro goes because it was, like, I started handling more and more team stuff, started doing a bunch of little stuff around at Haro outside of sales.
Right.
And then it got to the point where I was going on shoots for Fox with him, clothing catalog shoots, where he would just be like, I'll get you, come with me, I'll pay for you to be there. Like, I'll buy all your food and stuff, come drink at night with me, everything, and you have to learn. I'm like, okay, this is cool. So really kind of got into it kind of through him. Like, I was already into it. I was already shooting photos with Joe and them for fun. But at the time, Papiro and him was around. And I don't know if you know Scott Papiro, but, like, I was friends with him. But he is that dude that's like, I shoot with Joe. I shoot with this person. Right. Which, at the time, like, you
remember
could...
Remember the premium ads.
You could do that. Right. And it showed. But, like, I was lucky enough to have him and Pete Demos, two guys that don't use, you know, they have light mirrors and stuff, but they legitimately, both of them, look at their lens on their Bronica to focus. I've never seen them do anything more than one adjustment. I think I saw Papiro once do a Polaroid test shot.
All right.
So I got real lucky, because then through all that, Papiro kind of slowed down and he ended up doing some stuff. I think he went to DK at the time or something like that. So Pete was so busy at Haro with design work that he was still shooting and would go, but it was like, the riders would go to shoot, I'd go on a trip with him. He'd be like, here's my digital body. You handle some natural lights while I shoot this.
Right.
And I ended up shooting like two ads that way.
Nice.
Like an ad of Ryan Mills where like he got a black roll out of his Bronica. So I ended up shooting the ad.
Not bad.
And I just kind of, I don't know, I'm definitely lucky. Like, I still keep in touch with Pete Demos to this day. And like, I'll send him like a photo here or there. Or, like,
yeah,
he'll send me a photo and stuff like that. So I was like, I got fucking lucky.
Wait, so let me bring this back. How old are you now?
33.
Okay.
I'm old.
So it's relative.
Yeah.
What year did you move to Carlsbad to start working at Felt?
I was 22, 23, so had to been what, 2005?
05.
Yeah, 05.
All right. That makes sense. And then the digital body you were talking about, do you remember what the model was?
So it's kind of weird what happened. It was kind of funny. What happened was I was borrowing Pete's, like, he just gave me his flash bag and his 20D.
Nice.
And at the point, like, I'm just carrying his shit.
Yeah.
And it got to a point where, like, he would want to shoot something, and I had it in my car and was going to go riding with Joe at the end of the day or, like, go ride with somebody else at the end of the day. And so I got to a point where, like, one day somebody was like, yo, Pete's, like, you might want to talk to him. Like, you've had his bag for, like, a week. And I was like, me and Pete are friends. Like, I don't know why he wouldn't just tell me. And I went and talked to him. He's like, yeah, kid, time for you to step up your game. And luckily at the time, I was able to pin it against my parents and be like, you paid for my sister's college.
Oof.
I need $2,000. Because Pete was like, just go get your own, go get a 20D.
Yeah.
And I, like, luckily I had his guidance. He's like, buy the 7200 and a fish. I don't buy anything else. Shoot either wide or long. Don't fuck with anything else. And I'm like, awesome. Okay. So I went to the camera shop. I think at the time it was like $3,000 or something total. You know, like, my parents hooked it up.
Yeah.
I probably still owe them $3,000 to this day. But so I don't know. I got real lucky. Like, I used that for years. Like, I was still shooting that when I was working at staff in New Jersey.
Yeah. Okay, wait, so you grew up in Baltimore.
Yeah.
And then, but you were working in New Jersey at staff.
Yeah,
Central
Jersey.
No,
not even that. Like, I moved around. Like, I went Baltimore, Vegas, and then Carlsbad.
Uh-huh.
So I was around, like, Pete Demos. And at the same time, I was riding with Fudger a whole lot.
Uh-huh.
And, like, I have to give Fudger...
SDBMX.com?
This was right after that stop, and he had just got the job at Ride.
Nice.
Because Gary Young hooked him up. However he got the job, that was a good thing. So I was lucky to be around him too, because he, like, I gotta give him props, because sometimes, you know how it is shooting photos, another photographer sometimes can be like a little bit weird.
Oh, yeah.
You know, especially like at that time, Fudger definitely was better than me,
right?
For sure. And so he was never weird about it though. Like, I could ask him, you know, like, we just went and rode.
Yeah.
Like, it was obvious, like, oh, well, you're obviously shooting today, you got your camera bags, cool, like, I'll just fall back. But it was awesome because you gain so much knowledge. From
watching him, seeing
his mistakes, drinking beers with him at night,
yeah,
you know, like, little stuff. Like, I was shooting half minus on flashes for years, and he's like, dude, just shoot quarter plus and move 2 feet forward. You won't have any motion blur. I'm like, no fucking shit. Like, you know, like,
yeah,
you just learn, like, the little shit.
Yeah.
So then after that, I ended up leaving Haro. Basically what happened, it wasn't, like, any crazy bad blood or anything. I think what happened was I was over the sales position. There was nowhere else for me to move.
Yeah.
So it was like, you either stay and do sales and be lucky when you go on the team trips with Premium and get to shoot with the dudes and we let you out early and this and that. Or, you know, so it just, like, at one point I put 2 weeks in and worked doing freelance for a month and it worked out. But then it was like, I had all this downtime. I didn't know that many people in San Diego, and you could make a living, but I wasn't even close to at that point yet.
Right.
With photo.
Yeah.
And then, my backup plan was moving to Baltimore, back to Baltimore, to start a shop. So it was kind of crazy. Was I was already friends with, like...
Wait, what year are we at right now when you left Haro?
Probably, I wasn't there that long. Because, like, the thing with me is I can't sit at a cubicle.
Yeah.
Like, and no offense to them, like, at the time it was, like, there was one other sales guy that rode BMX and then Pete Demos. Uh-huh. And this other dude, Chris Racelis, who's still there, who still rides. So it was only, like, four of us out of 25 to 30 people that rode. Uh-huh. Like, at that point I had so much, now I think I might be able to handle a little bit, but now I had so much BMX blood that, like, it was a fucked up scenario to me. Yeah. Like, how is this dude designing parts that doesn't, like, he has a BMX bike, but he's not involved in the scene. Like,
yeah, it's strange,
if you're not out there every day, like, you're not seeing how something's breaking or how, like, the rider's really using it. Yeah. So, needless to say, I went. I heard Bob at staff. I already was friends with him through a working relationship. So he would randomly be like, oh, you want to come back to Baltimore? I'll fly you into Baltimore, come up to Jersey for 3 or 4 days, shoot with Brad Gethar, JJ, and maybe shoot with Garrett. I'd love him to be on staff, but he's on, I think, Nation.
Right.
What was the name of that shop? He was like, oh, he's on Nation now, but, like, you know, I know you know him. Like, so I went back there the one time. I just had a ball, and he was like, hey, I heard a rumor that you're starting a shop. And I was like, yeah, but I have no means to do it yet. I got to figure it out. Mm. And I got in the airport, and he was just like, text me a dollar number and was like, why don't we just talk more and you can move to Jersey? And at the time, it was like, fuck, like, I got to do this, like, you know, he was offering me something that Haro couldn't.
Yeah.
Like, he wanted me to help run the website, take all the pictures, do the ads and stuff like that. So it's like, okay, I watched Pete Demos do this for Haro for years. Like, I already know how the whole catalog process works. Like, I just got to spend some time behind Illustrator and learn more. So I just basically, I think I stayed back in Jersey for like a month of it. Or not back in Jersey, in Carlsbad for like a month.
Uh-huh.
And then just drove.
Back
and,
in Jersey?
Yeah, and it's crazy because it worked out. Because it was like I wanted a new challenge, and me and JJ and Brad Gethard were all just super close friends at the time.
Uh-huh.
So it was like, this is awesome. Like, I'm going to get to shoot in Philly. I never got to shoot in Philly when I lived in Baltimore because I didn't really shoot then.
Yeah.
I just got to ride it. So I'm like, I want to shoot. I want those red bricks. You know how it is on the East Coast. And it just worked out. Like, from there, like, ended up meeting, like, Garrett and Ty and all those dudes, and then
Everyone started to move back out to SD.
Yeah, it was kind of like a weird scenario because when they like moved back out, the whole point was kind of like, at first it was going to be like Ty and Garrett,
right?
And then they talked to like the whole issue, like Fiend kind of came up in the talk, and that was already started like when they moved out.
Yeah,
so it was weird. Yeah, and it was weird because the whole time me and Bob wanted something more than staff, like just a new challenge, you know, you run it, like, there's, you know, like, no shame in the game, like, there's only four mail orders, and at the time, it was us, Albies, and Empire, all trying to bite at Dan's ankles.
Yeah.
Well, they, you know, like, they have their shit dialed,
mm-hmm.
you know, they have the money back in them, they can do what they want, so unless you've got that much more money to put into it, you can't challenge yourself more and make more, and Jersey kind of had a little bit of a weird scene, I feel like. Not a weird scene, but, like, where we were pigeonholed. You've been to the Incline Club. Like, it's,
I've never been in there. But I know where it's at.
Yeah, it was, like, a real weird time shift in BMX in New Jersey, I feel like, because I feel like street riding was starting to become more normal, which was awesome for me because I'm not really I like shooting park, but it's not, it's the same thing every time.
Yeah, it's not as exciting.
Yeah, it's easy. It's, you know.
Yeah.
It's just, it's weird. But, it was kind of cool because it was something different. But at the time, like I said, staff was in this weird position where for us to grow, we would have had to move the shop. And at the time, it was just me running the shop. Bob had moved his family to Florida. So I was running the shop, but he was running all the back end of the business.
Okay, yeah.
So it was like, we need to either have a retail storefront like you guys do. Because at the time, it's like Incline Club got kind of overran by scooters.
Yeah.
And then a lot of park riders, which that's awesome. That's great.
Yeah.
But the marketplace was changing. And if you, like, sit inside here for 12 hours a day, you'll go fucking crazy.
Yeah, fuck
especially
that.
In the wintertime. Like, I would sit in that shop nonstop, and I had an office upstairs. So it was like just, it drives you insane. So luckily, Garrett saved me from that scenario. Or all the dudes, really. I mean, Fiend's not one person. It's six
that's
of
true.
Us. So it's like, that kind of got lucky when I moved back that me and Garrett naturally became friends, you know, so I got lucky in that scenario that, like, you know, I had already known him, but we became actual friends. So when they moved out to San Diego, was that, I'm trying to think, it would have been 3-4 years ago. I was originally debating on moving, but not necessarily moving with them because we had already started Fiend. But at the time, I needed to, basically, I want to do things on my own. So it's like, well, I'm not going to tell a new company, like, pay all my gas to get out there.
Yeah.
You know, and we needed to still take our time with staff because, you know, I only worked there for 5 years, but everywhere I worked like that, as far as that in Fiend, it's been more like family base.
Yeah.
So you don't want to just up and leave something that you care about. So we had to do it the right way, you know? And so it took a few years for me to get back to San Diego, but now I've been back for 2.5 years.
Okay.
Living the retirement life.
Well,
I love that Adam calls it that, by the way.
When did he say that?
Adam and Augie. Adam said it on a podcast.
But what, down in SD down there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is, though. It's kind of
like in Austin. I get the same vibe from Austin.
Probably. I wouldn't say it's full-on retirement, but I think it's funny because it's like, it's different than being up here. Like, I come up here and I almost feel like I'm on a bad psychedelic trick. Like, there's all these, like, everything's going everywhere and, like, I don't know, I'm from the East Coast, so I should be used to it. But now when I come up here, I'm like, fuck, this is crazy.
Yeah, no, you know? I'm sure if you get used to that relaxed lifestyle.
But it's weird. I always think it's funny when people call it that, too, because I'm like, I think when he called it that, I was mid shooting all this stuff for Red Bull and Garrett was filming his part. And like at the same time, it's like JJ's filming a part, like Colin's filming stuff. Yeah. Like I'm seeing all the homies going in and I've heard about stuff that Dennis has done and Christian's done. So it's like, it's not really retirement. Mm-hmm. And then I'm like, I guess we all kind of just until the weekend, we're kind of, you know, things still get done, but there's not that hustle bustle to get out every day to get a certain amount of hours riding.
Yeah.
You know, it's way more like a relaxed atmosphere.
Yeah. All right, so let's talk about what you do day to day these days with Fiend and with your own personal work.
Personal work's kind of like, lately personal work, I'm going to start a website, not really a photo website, but I've had one of my own, but I pulled it down like 3-4 years ago.
Okay.
And it's just sitting there. I want to do something with that. And to be honest with you, lately I've been feeling like, you probably know with shooting film, like you have a period like where you just know where everything is and you just know what your settings are.
Uh-huh.
So now with all the ISO options and shit, it's just like I found myself getting to a point where I'm like, I'm fucking around with my camera too much. Like, so I actually now, like I always carry my original Pentax. Like I fixed it like a month ago, pulled it all apart, cleaned it. So now I'm carrying that, and I've been trying to make a goal to shoot a roll every week.
Nice.
So I've been doing that, and then that's kind of the whole idea with the site is, like, give a place just for my images to lay.
Uh-huh.
So there's something final there, and that's kind of the goal with it, too. Like I said, I want to shoot more 35 again, so that way I can have something to post every day that's more personal work than BMX.
Right.
You know, I always love shooting a BMX photo more than anything, but at the same time, I think in my head, like, secretly would love to do even more documentary, like real raw stuff and show everything.
Course. I mean, I would hope anyone who's shooting BMX has a passion outside of just action sports.
Oh, if not, they should probably leave.
Look into that.
Because if not, you're just going to get broken. It's pointless.
It's all going to fizzle out.
But yeah, so I mean, other than that, like basically, I mean, shit, I guess my life is kind of retirement. Not really. I mean, I wake up in the morning and just kind of drink my coffee, have my morning smoke. And realistically with Fiend, like I end up doing a lot.
Uh-huh.
But it's a lot of, like, communications and different stuff. So, basically, the dudes kind of come to me with a product idea, hard good-wise. I get, like, the flat drawings done, some basic info to our friend John, who does all our CAD work for us. So, most of my days, I spend emails from Taiwan in the morning, finishing up from what happened the night before, making to-do lists, because I'm the most ADHD kid ever, so I have to have, like, a goal set for that day.
Yeah.
Or else it won't get done.
Yeah.
And then, realistically, I basically just keep myself busy with that to-do list until I get the text from JJ or whoever, like, hey, we're gonna go ride, or if we're cruising down the street or whatever.
Yeah.
Or sometimes I'm bugging those dudes at like 10 o'clock in the morning because I'm itching to go ride.
Yeah.
So it just depends, but that's like generally my normal day is do real work until 2, go shoot until 8 or whenever, and then come home, answer, you know, more emails. But yeah, so kind of
live
behind a desk in the morning, you know, for the most part. But it's kind of, in a way, it's kind of nice because I feel like it gives you, you don't get burnt out on things.
Oh, yeah.
And then you appreciate them more, you know. Like, I went out shooting Sunday. Was the first time since Montreal that I went out shooting with the homies, you know. Like, we had all ridden since then, but it was like, it wasn't even anything epic, but it's just like, you just get stoked. You're like, okay, I'm sitting on the ground again shooting a photo with some of my best friends. This is sick. Like,
yeah.
You know, so it keeps you amped on that.
Right.
which is good for me because I never want like photography, like, I don't know, I wouldn't want to burn myself out on something I love so much.
Yeah, that's why I was going to bring up the next question. We were just talking earlier. You do video work. Not with your 7D Mark II, your crop sensor.
Yeah, the crop sensor camera. I have done a couple of video work weddings.
Okay.
With one of my old friends from New Jersey, CJ, and it was always like friend of friend's wedding.
Right.
And basically, I'd sit my old 7D on a tripod, and then I would rent another one, do handheld stuff.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. Video stuff's fun because it's a challenge, but I'm not a videographer.
Right. Okay.
Like I feel like a wedding's different. Because I've shot enough weddings for blood money that I know, like, I know where the shots are. I can, it's the same as like riding. At this point, I can anticipate what all is going to happen. Like,
yeah.
You know, so it worked out.
Yeah.
But yeah, no video work at all. Ennis handles all that. I'll leave it to a real professional.
That's good that you got someone dedicated to that.
Yeah, it's important. Like, yeah. I think, like, I don't know, I think it's sick that all the Fiend dudes value both sides of it. Like, the video and photo end.
Yeah.
Like, they all know they can hit me and Tony up at any minute. Like, if Ty called me right now and was like, I'm going to go get that clip, Ennis is coming up, like, I'll gladly.
We'll have to cut this.
We'll have
short.
To cut this because I need to go. You
yeah.
know, like,
no,
it's not that I need to, it's that I want to.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, I think that's awesome too. Like, you know, I think it's important that all those dudes value that. You know, they know that, like, it's something to have a photographer and a video guy that want to work with you at your disposal.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It's natural. Like, there's no weirdness.
All right. Well, let's talk about how video seems to be taking precedence over photo these days.
Is it?
I mean, I would definitely say so.
Yeah, it
given
is.
I was going to say, yeah, dude, this isn't new. There's much less outlets, especially in print form for photographs. We have here the last print issue of Ride UK, which is a great
copy. Sad thing.
Whereas for video, you have you have just as many places online to put a photo as you do with video. But people are so used to, like, let's take Instagram, for instance. You're looking at a photo, you might double click it, swipe a photo, no, swipe. It's like
it's fast.
Barraged with all these bad, good, mediocre photos.
Yep.
You know, you don't even think that much about seeing a photograph anymore, you know? And then you come up on a video and you have 15 seconds and you're sort of, you get into it, you know, you'll watch it, you'll sit still for 15 seconds, maybe, you know?
I think, honestly, I think that's BMX's own fault.
Well, you think it's BMX or we're looking beyond BMX, beyond the BMX photograph?
I think beyond BMX, it's a action sports issue in general that our magazines are dying.
Okay.
Because I feel like, I don't know, I think I was lucky and somewhat saw it coming because I was kind of in the middle of that shift where it was like, there's still dudes shooting and making real money.
Right.
Like, I watched Pete get some paychecks that were quarter of my pay.
Yeah.
For the year.
Yeah.
You know, which is awesome. But at the same time, I would hear him mumble like, oh, Fox should have paid you this amount. That's what it used to be. Or, you know, what Ride used to pay me for one page. And it's like, really?
Yeah.
You know, like, you, realistically, you don't need to be at Hard. You could go shoot every day and make, not a killing, but you could live.
Yeah.
You know? Like, look at Thrasher. Like, I don't know if you look at their website, but
I look at their magazine.
Okay, so everything Thrasher does coincides with their magazine. They've been doing that for a few years now.
Uh-huh.
That's going to keep their magazine alive.
Okay.
Like, that magazine will outlast any of the other skate mags.
All right.
And I think that's kind of a good, I think that if that would have happened earlier on with every magazine and every website, instead of everybody putting such an emphasis on the paper aspect of it, which is, I mean, it's the ultimate goal to have your stuff printed.
Yeah,
it is.
Oh, yeah.
Like, you know, anybody that tells you elsewise is lying to you.
Well, or they're super young and they never used to hang posters on their wall.
Exactly.
And they never went to the newsstand to pick up the kids these days don't understand the value of it and they don't really care.
Luckily, my dad's always been completely down to help out and do whatever, but we used to drive 35 minutes to White Marsh Mall from my house to go buy Ride US when I realized, like, the first time I was in there, being a punk kid at the mall, doing whatever I was doing, at age, I think I was like 11 or 12, picked up the one with Rooftop on the cover. It had the old real shitty fucking,
the
real bad
font.
Logo.
Yeah,
it was before the weird
orange
font logo. Like, I think it was the third or fourth one.
Okay.
So, like, my dad would always drive me to there, so luckily I got to see the print stuff early on.
Uh-huh.
But it's just, I don't see kids nowadays, they're not, the value of the magazine isn't there anymore. Like, kids aren't going to drive 30 minutes to pick up a magazine.
Never.
But like I was saying, I think if, imagine if this was four times a year with no advertisers and it was a photo book and the website paid for a photo book to happen four times a year.
That would be
Would
sick.
Kids be willing to pay $20 for a photo
no.
top book? You don't think so?
No, because A, they're kids, they don't have a lot of money, and B...
That's true, but now things, you know, if you even 5 years ago, things are more obtainable online than they are in a bookstore. You're not going to order a magazine online to your house.
Dude, honestly, I think kids have their hands full of their fucking phones so much that they can't put it down to read a fucking
magazine. That's definitely
or a
true.
Book.
But
know?
That's what I was thinking. Like, if it was presented some way else.
Yeah.
And coincide with the website. So the website
okay,
could have been hyping
saying.
Up something that was more than just a magazine. Because,
right.
like, you know, I'm not naive. I know how this works, you know. Like, every advertiser pays for a page and pays for their riders essentially to get published.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
for their photos to get published in there. But I just think that we didn't, BMX as a whole didn't have the foresight to see the change coming, whereas other people did.
Yeah, okay. So I'm gathering the youth, the industry just sort of jumped ship on print and went straight to web and didn't even like
exactly.
look back and like try to coincide.
And they didn't think about the way it would be presented on web.
Yeah, they just went for
it. You know?
It. Yeah.
Like, that's the whole thing because, so you got Adam, whatever, Adam starts to come up. He's got this running RSS blog style feed,
uh-huh.
which is arguably the easiest way to
yeah.
gather the most amount of information fast.
Uh-huh.
Everybody just follows suit.
Yeah.
Why is everybody doing the same thing?
Yeah, exactly.
Why? Let Adam cover absolutely everybody's stuff. Your ride BMX, you know how much stuff you have sitting in the drawer?
Yeah.
Like, I know scans cost money, but you're scanning for online. You can use a $500 scanner. You don't have to
yeah.
jump scan everything. So it's kind of like, I just feel like as BMX, like, we kind of all messed up and should have had the foresight to see some things. I think Brad McDonald and them did with Vital, and I think that's awesome. Like,
yeah.
he kind of shifted place, even though he kind of left one baby to go to another.
Uh-huh.
But arguably, me personally, the content they have, I don't think is presented as good as it necessarily could be, you know, but it's also to a different genre.
Yeah,
I feel like
it definitely
that's, you
is.
Know, kind of like BMX Plus, kind of the more
different crowd.
Coming up crowd, you know.
Okay, let's backtrack for a minute. You were talking about how a good photograph really brings together an article and it makes the article more presentable, but. How do you feel about the photographer being compensated for that work, given that the photo is going online and won't generate a lot of ad revenue?
That's a real scary scenario. Because,
well, see, that's what I want to talk about is how okay. we can survive monetarily as photographers this day and age, or if we can, in BMX especially.
I don't want to sound like the bitter dude to say don't shoot BMX for money, but like we have to face it. This is a small industry.
Very.
And if you're not working in it for passion, you're not going to make any money because it's not going to show. No one's going to have any respect for you.
Yeah.
And you have to value, like, the fact that BMX puts a roof over your head. The simple things. You can't be like, oh, I want to go buy an Audi or I want to go buy this or I need
yeah.
this to live. You don't need that stuff. Like, if you really love BMX, you're going to do it for passion because I just don't see it. I don't know. At least for me, I don't think... Maybe I just don't have the hustle or drive in me. I guess I'm calling myself lazy.
Well, no,
but it's
mean...
like, I don't want to go out every day like today. I just sat around and hung out with Augie. I don't want to come up and be like, yo, Augie, shoot a photo, even though I love shooting with him. Like, I value the time just hanging out with him. And if I had to make a living off of it, that's the way it would have to be, and it'd be miserable.
Yeah, because we're working around other people. Our jobs, our livelihood depends on other people
exactly.
riding their bikes in the
yep.
way that they do.
So I think it's kind of, it's crazy to assume, it's crazy to know that BMX is a small industry and want it to grow, because we all want it to grow
yeah,
back to where it's something that, like, because ideal world, like, we should be making a little bit more money, everybody in BMX, especially riders. Like,
oh,
it's
yeah.
ridiculous that a pro rider is barely paying rent. Like,
yeah.
that person puts some life on the line anytime they're doing anything.
Yeah.
Like, that's retarded to me. So it's like we all need this thing to grow for all the better of all of us. So if you're in for it for money, just go. Like, this
yeah.
isn't your time.
Yeah.
It's no big deal, but you can't.
It is. I do see BMX in a recession of sorts. And I think that it's a good and it's a bad thing. Bad, obviously, because there's not a lot of money and
yeah.
a lot of people are doing a lot of shit and not getting
properly
compensated. But
And I it, don't. I don't want to sound bitter by saying that either, though, because I do believe that, like, hard work pays off. Like, obviously, you worked hard to get to where you're at. You're here now. You're able to sustain. Right. You know, look at Pavia. Yeah, he's doing a studio, but he still loves BMX. Like, yeah. He moved on to doing that. That's awesome. Like, that he has a focus on that, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's still, like, I don't want to take away from, like, anybody trying to be a photographer, a BMX photographer, but
that's
I feel like they should really understand that, like, you can't just do one thing. Like,
yeah,
as a photographer anymore, and as a video guy, you can. There's enough out there now because, let's face it, like, I mean, you know, like, we all do stuff for different websites. Like, there's not a website out there that hasn't pushed or pumped an edit out that really, it's like, all right, this was too, like, you know, come on, like, you know, like, put some more time into it, you know? But it is important for kids to see that stuff, and I think that's awesome that the video guys are able to make the money.
Yeah.
But, like I said, I mean, I just think it's important for people not to rob the industry they're from. And like you said, you got to do other stuff. I mean,
you have to. You adapt or die, honestly.
There's days that I'm sitting there zoomed in 500% to a CAD drawing that somebody else drew, checking radiuses, pulling segments out, or I'm measuring the shirt, or, like, you know, like, there's days I'm moving my whole couch to shoot products. Like,
yeah.
The other day I had to spend 10 hours doing cut paths on photos. Like, that's not necessarily fun, but at the end of the day, I know
you
it.
You have to do that.
I have to do it. Like, I want my stuff to look good. It's my photo. I want to learn how to cut path it. Do the cut paths and put it on the website myself. Like, So it's like, even with me, like, I built Fiend's website. Like, I'm not a web designer, but I want to make enough money in BMX to sustain my life and be able to keep shooting photos.
You got
to
wear many hats.
There's Google these days. Like, there's books. You can still, Barnes & Noble's still open, so you can still go there now. Like, anything's, like, obtainable. You just have to, you have to wear different hats.
There are a handful of photographers in BMX making money, living solely off of photos. But those people are working their asses off day in, day out.
They are, too. Like, I don't know. Like, I mean, I haven't seen Fudger for like a month, but last time I saw him, and me and him had like a, you know, I think we were both smart enough not to have too many BMX conversations at this point in our life because we just want to be friends and hang out. But it's like, you know, you bring out the magazine and like you can see the stress in his face, how many hours like he's got to put in, you know, and you know secretly he don't want to answer emails. He wants to go out and shoot like the rest of us.
Everyone wants
to
go ride. In the end of the day, everyone just wants to ride.
It's like the few dudes that are, you know, like, Cosman's doing video stuff too, but
he's doing the Vans video.
Cosman's got fucking hustle. Yeah. It's Cosman. I think Calvin's helping film that. Augie orders by Joe every time he orders Starbucks.
Really?
Yeah. It's always Joe. Like, he orders coffee or whatever. It just cracks me up because it's like the consistent now. Like, I don't think it's in his head that like, it's just Joe.
That's too funny. Augie's a great guy. Super funny. All right. Let's go through your bag before we get off topic here.
Cool. All right, just so everyone knows, the bag's new, so it's usually not this clean. I just got really, really tired of my old bag killing my back, and I started having back issues, so I decided to waste money on another camera bag. Sorry, these are both too small. It's just a cheap silk one and a cheap folding light stand. I do carry a real tripod pretty similar to that, but like I said, my back's kind of an issue right now. Not a bad issue, but I'm weary of it, so right now, unless I need it, I keep those around. And then, so for camera, it's a 7D Mark II with a 40mm on it as a lens cap. If anybody doesn't know, this is the secret $200 lens. I probably shot more photos than realistically I should have ever shot with this lens.
That's that pancake 40mm?
Yeah, it's actually accidentally a good lens.
Excellent.
I don't know how it is. Like, I randomly bought it at a camera store, and I don't know, I love it. And then, so it's crop sensor, like I said. So 8-15 zooming fish. Everyone loves the 15mm. I still have one with a ruined flange, but I swear by this thing now. I swear it's a little bit sharper.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I swear it is. Even though it's a zoom lens, I really feel like it is. Maybe I think I was real finicky with the 15mm focus ring.
Right.
I feel like it was always a downfall on that lens.
Oh yeah. It was always loose. Yeah.
Yeah. So I never focused that lens. Like, I just, it had its sweet spot like any fish eye. So I left it on there. Then I just got the 24-105. I always had the 24-70, but thanks to a flight back from Tulsa when we did that cinema trip,
It's just all broken glass.
Shit, really?
So I needed to buy a new one, and Ty put me on. He's like, dude, just get that. And I'm like, I'm never, like, for what I would use this for, I don't really need 2.8. Like, that's not an issue.
Right.
Because if I'm shooting a wedding and I want 2.8, bump I'm not going to shoot this ceremony 2.8. Yeah. So I can just throw the pancake on.
Oh, okay.
Or something. And then, of course, the 70 to 200. This is the OG one. I think this is actually 12 or 13 years old now. It's been rebuilt a few times, but still runs real good. And this is all just your basic random pocket wizards, some plus X's, some of these, or some gray ones. And then I do...
Gray ones or blue ones?
I think I got blue. You know what? No, the gray one's on my medium form body, actually, but I do still have some gray ones. And then I do hypersync sometimes, not very often though.
Yeah.
So just a bunch of random. The new pocket wizard cable that lets you remote.
Remotely shoot.
So this is perfect. For,
nice.
Exactly. It's perfect for stitch sequences, so that way I can be out of the way if I need to be.
Perfect.
Then I just got Einstein flashes, actually recently.
Dialed.
So it's Einstein with the Vagabonds. Before that, I was always on the Q flashes.
Really?
For years. Yeah, I don't know what it is. I think it was actually Pete Demos' fault. It was always two Qs, two Vivitars, you're good. So I ran that until, actually at the end of Fiending, I bought the Einsteins.
Nice.
So thanks Red Bull.
Good purchase, right?
Yeah, thanks Red Bull for two Einstein flashes. So yeah, I still shoot the Q as my third flash. Like I said, these are beat and stuff, but I don't know. They're cheap now. I think they're like $150 worth of battery used on eBay, and they're good flashes. And then this is the first camera I ever owned, which was my dad's, then my sister's, and I still shoot with it now.
Nice.
I don't know. I just think it brings it back to having to actually think about it.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, it makes you slow down a little bit. So that's pretty much my whole bag. Anything else is just a standard 430 or what are these things? Yeah, it's a 430. It's just a super backup. Sometimes, lots of times when I'm on trips, honestly, like in... We were just in Montreal. I didn't carry the Q flash to keep 5 pounds off my back, so I just brought this or 285, whatever at the time.
Nice.
But other than that, the only thing else that's sometimes in the bag is a Bronica SQ. But that's kind of these days a love-hate relationship. So one of those things where like I wish I could just shoot with it all the time.
Yeah.
But realistically, if you want a good scan, you're paying a shitload of money. So
that's the thing about film. Especially medium format, if you're not going to scan it properly with like a real nice drum scanner,
yeah,
there's really no point in having all the crystal clear optics.
Thing. Like I shot Garrett's Rincon Whip with the medium format, and it's like that was $120 a day to get that developed. And like I don't have any second guess about doing it or anything like that, but it's like it was $120 to get the image where I needed it to go.
Yeah.
And now it's like
forever immortalized.
That image isn't going to sell for $120 if you want to really cut it down to that, but it's like, it's just kind of funny that you almost can't.
Yeah.
You know, luckily, I think it's important for people to still do it, and I wish I could nonstop, but.
Yeah. What reflectors do you use on the Alien Beast?
On the Einsteins, what are they? They're 11 inches, right? The big long ones?
Yeah.
I have those, then I have the stock normal one, and then the one in between, because I didn't really know what to get.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, I'm going to get a wide range, because that's, like, I still do studio stuff. And
right.
I feel like, honestly, like, lucky enough with San Diego last time, same thing as here, you're driving around to a school last time, Saturday and Sunday, so I can bring all four.
Yeah.
And with, like, I do so many stitches and stuff like that, all the stitches at night, I don't shoot with the 11 inches, I shoot with the shorter ones.
Yeah, you know.
Because it's a little bit wider throw on
it,
and I need to fill in the ground a little bit somehow, so.
Word
but
up.
Yeah, for the most part, just the 11-inch ones.
Cool.
But yeah, so that's it. Pretty basic bag. I don't care, laptop or any of that stuff in it. And then anything else I have is just stickers, because not anybody always has them on it. And then these are actually lens cloths from my grandfather's camera bag. And then, I don't know, extra memory cards. And then I always carry, let me get it out. In here somewhere, stuffed in there, is a little Ziploc denim bag that I just carry lens cleaners and stuff with.
Nice.
And extra sync cables, because they always go out.
Yeah, so they do.
You have to have something, so I always carry 2 or 3 extra sync cables.
There you go.
But yeah, so I mean, that's pretty much
what it. What model bag is this? I'm very curious.
It's a big one. Dude, it's big, but it's comfy. It's a 640, 650 AW. And it was real weird because I was, I had, before I had the Tamarack Super 9 Expedition,
yeah, yeah,
whatever, and I had that for so long, and that's an awesome bag, but I ran into the problem where I was like watching my equipment get ruined. And I'm not anal with stuff at all, but when I, so my 7D went out, if anybody's seen the last clip in Garrett's Red Bull part.
Yeah, everyone has.
Sequence, it went out, and then, yeah.
Oh, shit.
So on the ride home, it was like, you know, and he knew it because I stopped shooting, and he didn't know, like, I think at the time it was just kind of like, I was like, yo, I'm just standing in the way because,
yeah,
like, my camera can't sequence, the shutter just locked up, it was doing crazy stuff, which is always a scenario, I run them until they're dead. So at the time, I bought this, and then right after that, got the flashes, so I was like, okay, I got some new stuff, it's time to have a better quality bag, so. But no, this bag's been awesome so far.
Nice.
And I rode with on my back in Montreal and stuff like that, it's not that bad at all. But yeah, like I said, I just needed something bigger, because especially with the Einsteins too, I found,
oh, yeah,
they're so tall, like,
oh,
like,
yeah,
it, the bag ends up going like this.
Yep.
And it's, you know, so that's kind of an issue. And like I said, this gives me room. If I want to pull something out, I can put the medium format in it. So.
This is definitely a 50-pounder, huh?
It's over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With the with the stands and a tripod, you said?
Yeah, yeah, usually I have. So usually I just, when it's shut, you just run. I don't know. I think actually I stole this from Chris Morrison without him knowing, because Tony told me.
Huh.
For a while, I was just strapping on the 11-inch reflectors.
Yeah.
And he's like, no, you got to do what Morrison do. You just hold the tripod, stick them through.
Yeah.
So it's like I've got the two small ones on the side, then the big one here with those
reflectors.
Because these, like this guy, actually I haven't even, I don't even know if it'll really hold an Einstein. I haven't tried it yet, but I think it's stable enough.
Yeah.
So it's just like one of those things you're just trying to save weight because.
Always.
Dude, it's, some trips you ride more, like when we were in Montreal, didn't ride much, but when we were back in Philly, that was like, that was a year and a half ago, it killed my back. So
yeah,
at that point, it's like I need to start getting some lighter equipment and stuff like that.
Seems like people, like even when I bought that camera, people were a little bit, like even Ennis, like, you're not going to get the full frame, you're not going to get a 1DX, but you can't, you know, as much as like, I'd like to admit I could own one, but I can't, you know, it's, they're expensive, you know, so you got to work towards it. You got to prioritize, and I don't.
Dude, as long as you have that 8mm fisheye, the crop sensor ain't shit.
Yeah.
Like, it's still, what is it, 23 megapixel? What is it, 72?
I think it's 23.
Yeah, it's up there. And dude, on like once, as long as you're above 10.
Eight and a half megapixels.
What, that six? The iPhone 6?
No, but I'm saying, so it used to be, like, not used to be, I guess it still is. Technically, 8.5 pixels can almost be as good a quality as a scanned slide.
Okay.
Depending on who does the scan.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, like you said, if you get a drum scan, it's a whole different scenario.
Yeah.
But the general person isn't scanning a slide, so not a drum scan, at least,
no,
you know. So I feel like sometimes lots of people are misguided into what to buy.
It's all about numbers these days.
Yeah.
You can stuff as many megapixels as you want in a camera, but the fact is they're smaller megapixels, and they're,
exactly,
they're not going to be as valuable as larger, better megapixels.
Exactly. That new 5D I read there, and it has like 53 or something.
Yeah. They're just miniature pixels. Well,
how big are you blowing stuff,
yeah,
up? Like, I don't, it sounds crazy, but so I had a Dutour thing on the side of a bus.
Shot a 70.
And this was a couple years ago, so I'm trying to remember the image, but I think, yeah, it was shot no flashes and it was noisy as shit and it looked fine.
Really?
Yeah. I was like freaking out because I wanted, like, I made Josh send me a picture of it because I wanted to see it. And I was like, I'm just curious how it printed, blah, blah, blah. You know, and it printed just fine. Like,
really?
I was like, that like shows you how far you can pull it. It wasn't the whole side of a bus, but I think it was like 6 feet wide or,
yeah,
something.
It
so it's like,
rad, yeah,
if you can pull 6 feet out of a regular 7D, and that was like, that was an awesome camera when I first got it. You know, like it was, I liked it when I first got it, had that and a 1DS or something, or maybe I had a 1DS Mark II, something like that.
Yeah.
At the time, but that camera still pulled, like I said, it pulled its weight all the way through,
yeah,
Fiending. Anything that, pretty much anything anybody's seen that I've shot is still 7D stuff, because I just got the 7D Mark II when, it was right when we started, right when Garrett started filming for the Red Bull stuff, and right when we went on that trip, that, like Ty and all, everybody went on the trip, because I remember I was talking to Ty before that about what should I buy, because people don't know this, but Ty's a retarded good photographer.
Really?
And he'll never own up to it. You know how many times I've tried to do galleries with him? Like, it's been an ongoing, ever since he started writing for staff, I wanted to do him to do a gallery on the staff side.
He shoots 35 millimeter, doesn't he?
D- Ty's got a Bronica too.
Really?
And he shoots really.
Oh, you know what's funny is at his place he has studio. He's got a Q flash.
Yeah, he's got.
He?
Yeah.
And he has like what other flash? Is it a speed light?
Got more than that.
And he's got the softbox. I was like, what are you shooting here?
Well, because I'm sure that stuff was for trip apparel.
Yeah.
But it's pretty funny because I don't think I don't know, dude. I honestly think if Ty really wanted to shoot photos, and be a professional photographer,
he could.
It's only a matter of not him going and doing it. Like, I've seen, there's a Harrington picture of Josh doing a 50-50 grind hop over bar, I believe it was.
Yeah.
That no one's ever seen, and it should have been printed in
Ride. Is the one from Deadline?
Yeah.
Okay.
It should have been printed in Ride.
Really?
It's that good.
Perfect timing?
Yeah, perfect timing. Jeez. Fucking barspins.
Yeah, I could see Ty being, Ardo Sari from Skateboard.
Yeah.
Legendary skateboarder, now legendary photographer.
Mm-hmm. Oh, for sure.
I could see Ty being one of those.
He has a couple pictures that he showed me years ago off his Bronica when I first met him, and I'm just like, you could tell he had the right eye, he knew how to paint the picture in his head, and he knew how to make it work.
Damn.
And with a Bronica, that's not without no light meter, or battery in the camera, you have to know what you're doing.
Yeah.
I don't think he even owned a digital at the time.
Jeez.
But he definitely knows how to shoot a photo.
So what film do you load up in your Bronica?
On the Bronica?
Yeah.
Provia.
Provia still. 100 or 400?
100. Never 400.
I've shot maybe two of those.
Yeah, I don't think it's bad. Sometimes I've been shooting Porta print film actually lately.
Portra. Portra 1?
Is that what it is? Portra 1, yeah.
There's 1.48. 1.48, yeah.
It'd be 1, yeah.
Yeah.
So just 120 of that. I don't know. Sometimes I like the print film. I think it gives it, and that's part of the reason I've been shooting 35.
Oh, I love print film.
It gives it this really raw feel. It's just rough. It's not perfect.
Yeah. No, I like it. You get a better tonal range. You don't need to be exact with your exposures.
Exactly.
Something I love.
And you can also, the spot metering is better on it.
Yeah.
It's
just easier, I'd say. because I don't think the average photographer these days shooting 35mm even shoots slide. All the kids I knew with the fucking Yashica T4s, they all love
slide film's hard to find.
Well, and it's probably hard to develop. I can't even think of the last E6 slide.
Yeah, that's the other thing too, is that for E6 stuff, the only people I know of are right off Pacific Coast Highway in Carlsbad, and they're amazing.
Okay.
And they're fast. And the lady there's a sweetheart because I'm a mess and that's a 40-minute drive for me. So I'm always the guy that just comes up and expects them to do it in an hour.
Yeah.
And she's always like, all right. And it always turns out perfect. But so I have to drive up there, get that done. And then I can't press her to do any scans there.
Yeah.
So then I go to another guy right by my house.
Yeah.
Who's amazing at black and white and everything else. But he told me flat he can't do E6. And it used to be Chrome down in San Diego killed the E6 game. Well, I believe they got sold, and now they mainly just do prints, and they do an amazing job at prints, but I don't know. It's just, it's hard to get E6 developed. It's hard to find it. I definitely am sitting on a lot.
eBay. I used to buy bulk on eBay. I remember buying a case of 50 rolls of Provia once.
See, I'm not that bad, but I'm pretty bad with it. I just bought 25 rolls the other day just because, and they're 4 years expired.
Yeah.
They're still good.
Yeah.
I mean, just because the camera store had them and he wanted $1.50 a roll, I'm I'll shoot them. No problem.
Nice.
But yeah, always ISO 100. I don't know.
That's a thing.
Digital's different. But
on the West Coast, you can get away with shooting ISO 100 any day of the week. But on the East Coast, you got clouds, you got winter. Dude, you need some 800 and
shit. I was talking to my buddy Ben who shoots skate stuff.
Ben Clemens.
Yep.
Clemens. Yeah. He's
a man.
Is he from Cincinnati? Why do I know him from?
He's from Cincinnati, but he lives down in San Diego now.
Yeah.
And I was talking to him the other day about how he came over to borrow my old Q flash actually because one of his broke or something. And so I'm borrowing my old flashes and we're just sitting there talking on the porch. He's like, man, I'm kind of over this Blue Sky Cali shit. It's getting over to him. It kind of is. I agree with him sometimes. Same thing with video stuff. The raw East Coast look.
Yeah. There's
is
something
nice.
To it. I remember. We'll keep it on the skateboarding kick here. My friend Dan Forgan, Cleveland skateboarder, this was back in 2005 maybe. He was shooting with Jonathan Maring, I want to say, which was one of the better skateboarders.
Yeah, yeah.
Or was it him or was it...
I'm trying to think of who other than Maring would have been living in that area or would have...
Whoa, it might have been Brian Gaberman, who's like just a genius of photography.
He's ridiculous.
Yeah, and it was one of the two. Either way, I was like, fuck, you're shooting with him.
Yep.
But they waited for a day that it was cloudy, and I thought that was awesome. Yeah, because it's easier to create your own lighting when the sun isn't beaming through.
Plus, if you get tired of the sun, like I was just kind of in that situation in Montreal on like, you know, somebody was trying to trick, and it's getting ready to thunderstorm, and like I'm sitting there, I'm like, this is going to look like crap. It's going to thunderstorm. Like, there's no light left for me. This is definitely a sequence, but this would look so sick long with two flashes. Like, it was just ideal. Like, so common sense where the flashes need to be.
Yeah.
And, like, I'm sitting there. I remember, like, Ty being like, what, you're not going to shoot this? And I'm, like, just thinking to myself, like, F you, dude. This is going to look so noisy. Like, I'm not, like, I want it to be perfect.
Yeah.
But it can't be.
Never.
So, at the same time, it's like, yeah, like, why? Like,
yeah.
What, the, like, I still need to make it the best it can be.
Yeah.
And then, day, I'm happy with it, and the rider's happy with it. It's fine.
That's the greatest part is, more often than not, the rider's happy with it regardless.
Yeah.
As long as you don't, like, cut off an extreme body limb or, like, just completely botch the exposure, like, they're going to be like, oh, because they're already buzzed from landing it. Like, ah, yeah, they see the footage.
That's true.
Yeah.
Dude, that's the best thing about it. Like, there's so many photos I've, like,
yeah, whenever
not messed up, but like, you know, like if you're shooting a stitch sequence, it's so easy to get rid of the photographer or the video guy by having him move out of the way.
Yeah,
like this one's like a cab whip out or whatever that Garrett did in the Red Bull video. Like, it was kind of funny because I was like, I was on one that day. Like, I just had a real good breakfast with my mom. Like, I think I smoked a joint or something. I was really like, I was hyped.
Yeah,
and like I knew what we were going there for. You know, so you know how it is. Like, if you know what you're going there, and the rider really cares about it.
Yeah.
And like we pull up into the parking lot and following. Yeah, I've had this scenario in my head. Like, I'd been there, so I knew where stuff was gonna go. So I was like excited.
Yeah.
You know. So I think Ennis has a clip of me going, "This is it. Like, he's got it. Like, like trust me from the last one." And then that was it. And the whole time I'm like, "Ennis, make sure you fucking remind me not to fucking move, because I shot it freehand."
Yeah.
I'm like, don't let me move, because my tripod was a piece of shit at the time. So I'm like, tripod it, but it's more like a stick. So
yeah.
You know, and then so it's like instantly I just have to get up and hug both of them, because I'm just so happy that like it went down.
Yeah.
You know, like I'm happy that like you put yourself through the battle of getting the trick and you got it. And then I'm looking at the image and I'm like stoked, you know. So it's like, it's a good feeling. Everybody messes up at times.
Well, dude, that what I was getting at is when you shoot the photo and they land the trick quickly and you don't have time to like you see the photo coming together and it's like, all right, it's almost there, and then they land it and you're like, oh shit, like I wanted to make another adjustment, but here it is, check it out, oh that's dope. And in the background you're like, it's all right.
That happens, and like arguably I'm lucky in that facet that like the stuff, like, so you know, obviously I mainly just shoot with the Fiend dudes, which like thank God, because I love those dudes.
Yeah.
Like, I'd be doing that anyway. Like it doesn't matter, I would do that anyway. Those are the homies.
Yeah.
So I get lucky in the fact that, like, what they're trying, it's not a first-try trick.
Right.
90% of the time.
Yeah.
Because they're not going to shoot something, like, I mean, we can go by the water all day and shoot hot bars or tail whips on banks, and it's going to look sick, but, like, you should always want to put your best stuff out there.
Yeah.
Which is awesome to me that they're like that. So it's, like, lots of times I get lucky where, you know, it's like, okay, cool. Like, you're going to do one more up. Like, I won't even hold them. They'll just, you know, it's natural at this point. They'll see me run to a flash, and it's like, click, good.
Yep.
You know, and, like, I get lucky that time. Like, I just had that conversation with somebody. They were like, I don't know how you got that stitch. I'm like, you saw the trick. Like, how did I fit it? Like, he didn't pull that in 2 minutes. Like,
yeah.
You know, it was, like, this ridiculous trick Colin did, and I showed the clip to Wes, actually. I showed Wes a photo, and it was just one of those things where he's like, how'd you get all that? I'm like, what do you think? He just did all that in a row? Like, no, he did that part and that part. So I had that saved.
Uh-huh.
So then I could go ham with the rest of it and risk it and get it how I wanted to, you know? So I'm like, I got lucky in that aspect.
So you're a big fan of the stitch sequences.
Dude, you have to be.
That's what I'm saying.
Fan.
You have to be these days, because the way BMX is, it's so technical.
Exactly.
There's fakies, there's bars out, there's bars in, there's 180s out.
You don't have a choice.
In.
Like, and it's weird too, because like, I mean, anybody loves to set up strobes, because, you know, then if you have two strobes, you can do whatever the hell you want to a picture.
Oh, yeah.
Like, and no cockiness, any of us that have been shooting for more than 5 years with strobes know, like,
you know where they go.
You know where they go.
Yeah.
You know what you can do with the natural lighting, you know? So it's almost to the point now where, like, the stitch stuff, I probably shoot too much. Okay. And should probably shoot more regular sequence, but then that goes back to how it's presented on the web.
Well, yeah, no.
I'm sitting on so over I could a regular... put a sequence out every fucking weekend for the next year and be fine. It's ridiculous because it's like, how do you present this? You know?
Yeah. Okay. Hold on. It's obvious why you do the stitch sequence this day and age rather than a frame
exactly.
frame. But the whole act of shooting the sequence in itself, that's where I have to put down the photo camera and pick up the video camera because video takes precedence in my line of work right now, my position. I have to.
And that's understanding.
I can probably count on one hand the amount of stitch sequences I've ever shot.
Really?
I'm just not,
dude.
Like I said, if it requires like more than one frame, I'll just film it and I'll film the shit out. I'll film it as well as I can, you know?
I think what got me liking stitch sequences was the old strobe. The strobe sequence. Strobe sequences are the real way to do it.
Yeah.
Anybody doing it with a digital camera, I give them props. They all do double exposures now. That's awesome. But all of us, like, look at Jeff C. How many of those? He probably has so many slides with dialed strobe sequences that people need to see.
Yeah, no, imagine that.
But I remember, like, the first time I was showed one, it was in Papiro's car, showed me a picture of, I think it was Harrington, doing a rail.
Okay.
And he was real, like, weird about it. Like, oh, you got to have this camera. Don't worry about it. You know, like, kind of weird. And, like, I respect that, you know? So then I started at one point. I still have it. I have an old Canon 1N35 that, like...
The 1N RS?
Yeah.
10 frames per second.
Yep. Oh, and that was the first camera, I believe. I might be ignorant to this, but I believe that and the 1VHS are the only ones that actually can handle a real strobe sequence.
Okay.
So anyway, I have that, and I still use it. Like, I still will bring it on trips. It always is in a bag somewhere.
Yeah.
I don't use it as much. And if I'm shooting in San Diego, it's in my bag because sometimes I want black and white, so I'll do that. But anyway, so I had asked Pete Demos, like, how do you do that? And he's like, what, this? And he clicks on a picture. I still remember the image this day because it's like my mind's blown. Like, I knew about double exposures, and I could shoot them, but I never really understood.
How exactly.
So I understand how it happened, but you know what I'm saying, exactly how you do it.
Yeah.
And he's like, and it's his daughter on a swing, and there's 10 of her like this. My daughter shot this. I'm like, shut up, dude. He's like, you shoot one, then you shoot the rest of them, you're good. I'm like, what? Set up regular, shoot one, and shoot the rest. I'm like, it's like that? And I remember the first one I ever did was JJ 360 and over a picnic table, and I still have it. But like I said, unfortunately, you can't shoot film anymore. So
yeah.
I don't get to do it that much, but I think that's what got me into shooting stitches because it's one of those things where, like, you need to see that whole trick, like, what's
going on.
Like, what are you, if it's a bar crank bar or what, like a tuck ice, you can shoot just the tuck.
I just want to laugh at the fact that you said bar crank bar because we know who you're shooting with when you're talking about tricks like that.
Well, that one's fresh in the mind because I was recently sold some photos to Red Bull, and it was funny because I had to explain to them how important it was that both bars were there because to them, the crank arm was pleasant enough and really stood out, which I understand because it's not a BMX guy at the end of the day looking at photos.
They don't know what
so I had to explain to him, and luckily he was totally cool with it, totally understood and everything, you know? But it's like, you know, you can't not show that part.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And it's like...
One of the stitch sequences I ever done, it was... Craig Passero Primo ad. It was back on Albion from what I remember, but it was somewhere else too. In one place it ran, it showed the whole frame where he had to hop onto a curb and a sidewalk.
Oh, I remember.
A regular
width
sidewalk. He had to hop and then he had to do this gap three nose bonk.
And you want to see the hop.
You have to because
or else you're
not showing it. I think it was on the back cover of Albion, you couldn't see that he had to do a quick hop onto the sidewalk and then go. It just looked like a wide open run up.
Yep.
And it changes the whole trick.
It really does. Like the whole setup has so much to do with it now.
Yeah.
And I kind of like the stitch and sequence thing because in a way it's kind of a challenge.
It is.
It's something new.
Especially with flash.
Exactly, especially with flashes. And that was one of the main reasons I got the Einsteins. They're more powerful. You can pull
they're
them further
too.
Back out, and they're quicker.
Yeah.
So you can get away with a lot more.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I try to remain true to just shooting the frames I'm using.
Exactly.
Very rarely do I just let it run.
Overkill, yeah.
Sometimes I do, but not nearly as much anymore. You know,
it's
usually just the one or two frames. But yeah, I don't know. I really wish I didn't have to shoot as many, but like I said, I think it's a new challenge.
Yeah.
And it's awesome. Like, it's kind of crazy because, like, sometimes now I'll watch the way Tony's filming something not to steal the angle, but like I'm with sequences starting to become like to a point where it's like, oh, to make this fun, I'll start try to have an in and an out.
Yeah.
Like instead of just this is a sequence. Like yeah. have an in and out, make it more cohesive, I guess. Yeah. So I don't know, that's been kind of cool lately too.
That's cool. No, it's like a different ball game when you have a lot going on
exactly.
in one frame.
And that's really those dudes are really the whole reason I bought a crop sensor camera, because it's like if not, I probably would have maybe got a 5D3 or something when yeah. I went to replace my one, but I have to be able to shoot sequences.
Yeah.
Like it's just
their level of riding.
I'm not gonna not shoot because it's a sequence. Like,
yeah.
You know, and I would hate to be in that position where
I guess I'm blessed in that regard that I don't have to shoot something if I don't want to.
Yeah.
I do have to film it though.
It's but. Not that I have to shoot it if I don't want to, because I want to.
Yeah.
Like I won't shoot a photo if I don't like. I mean, I always want to. So do you yeah. see what I'm saying? Like yeah. I never.
There's always some
I always
way to document
want to.
Something.
Exactly. But yeah. at the same time, like I said, like in Montreal, like you know, there was one trick where, like I said, it was just real noisy, and it was like it just. I don't know. I was hungover still. The night before was my birthday, I was hungover still. So it was like one of those scenarios where I was like, I was feeling I wanted to shoot the photo, but it wasn't working the way I wanted, and I was genuinely bummed.
Yeah.
You know, but it's all right. You have to deal with
yeah.
that sometimes.
No,
and
you
at
can't
that
win
time,
them all.
Like, at that time, it's that's when it's like, you almost got to think more, you're documenting what is happening.
Yeah.
It might not be exactly what you want, but.
That's what Mortensen brought that up
yeah,
a few months ago.
Yeah, and that's important, dude.
It like, is. You can, and not everything can look picture perfect, Chris.
No,
happy.
Why would you want it to?
No, it's not actually how it is all the time.
It's
so
never
I'd be lying.
Like that.
Yeah.
And so I think that's a whole problem with lots of stuff today. Like,
it has.
I
to
hate
be.
The level of photoshopping that's going on.
Yeah.
Like I mean, yeah. I don't know.
Just no. It's,
I hit. I'm really bad, admittedly. Like it's weird because I use Photoshop. I use Illustrator for design, Photoshop, and stuff, and I go back and forth. So it's not that I don't know how to do that stuff. It's just that. To me, I shoot the photo knowing the three adjustments I do.
Mm.
That's it.
Yeah, that's all.
Like, if I have to do more than that, then, like, I'm saving a third. Like, it ain't, it's not
what
worth
you,
it.
Levels, curves, what adjustments
do
you
do? I don't do curves.
What do you
do?
Curves.
What do I do?
Yeah.
Oh, I just started using Lightroom after Ty's one yelling at me, it's so much better, so much better. And
I don't
was
use
still
Lightroom.
Like, yeah, I was still like a fucking CS5, like,
yeah,
whatever, it works
that's
fine.
That's all I'm doing.
Honestly, all I do is before anything, I look at the blue and yellows.
Okay.
I do all my stuff to mainly blue and yellows because it's cool or hot. And lots of times I'm shooting into the sun intentionally, so I'm wanting something or something like that. So I'll go and adjust my blue and yellows in Lightroom first. Then what I do from there is look at the temperature. It's either, I either go plus or minus the littlest bit, not even much.
Uh-huh.
And then from there, clarity 13, vibrance 13, saturation -3.
Wait, why 13 though?
Just works. Dude. It has nothing to do with it being a bad luck
no,
number.
No, no, I know it's not.
I feel like
everyone's bad number.
I feel like once you're above 13 to 15, if it's an in focus picture, you're ruining it.
Yeah, you don't need that.
And I don't shoot at f/8 very often. Like I will on a stitch sequence, I try to stick to f/8 if I
yeah.
can because of the range. But for the most part, I'm shooting at 5.6 or right below it.
Okay.
So I feel like using any more than clarity that you're ruining the depth of the field of photo, and
yeah.
then it looks like you shot on a mirrorless camera. Which,
yeah.
no
yeah.
offense, like I agree, there's some benefits. Like
yeah, but it'll never be the same.
It'll never look the same.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, but
that's unfortunate.
So yeah, I don't do much in Photoshop.
Yeah,
really at all. Like yeah. I just feel like it's
that's funny. 13 -3 saturation.
Yeah, saturation adds noise.
No, yeah,
doesn't.
I know, post-saturation, yeah, but when you shoot in camera, do you have everything flattened out or negative or what?
Just however it came.
Oh, okay.
I don't touch my camera settings. Like,
okay.
They're, like, digital, like, that's the whole problem. Canon needs to stop the bullshit with the video and the camera and all these settings. If it's a $1,500 camera, the person buying that camera should be able to shoot it in manual at all time.
Yeah.
Like, weddings, I don't shoot weddings in anything but manual. Like,
right.
Why? Like, I'm selfish. I want control of
yeah,
what's
exactly.
coming out, you know? So I think it's like a little ridiculous. Like that's, you know,
that's
that there's all this stuff. It's too much. Like I don't, my camera's on auto white balance. I didn't even set my dates and it cost me so much. Like everyone set your dates. Cause I was like, never had set a date on a camera.
Yeah.
And then I had to do some deliverables with dates on them. And that was a whole different, then yeah. I'm like, I gotta make up these dates.
Yeah.
And I don't remember anything, you
yeah.
know? So it's like, I'm trying to remember this stuff, but, like I don't know, it's just there's too much there, and I miss there not being all that there.
That's why you got
so
the
I just leave it.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons why I've been carrying the Pentax.
Yeah, like,
exactly.
Carrying that's the awesome, the Renaissance.
Plus, like, where I live in San Diego is kind of like the border. You know, like, not the border of San Diego or the border of Mexico, but the other side of the freeway is not the best neighborhood.
Yeah.
So my neighborhood's mad comical. Like, lately I've just been pedaling around with the camera.
Yeah.
And it's just like, dude, the characters are out of control.
Yeah, that's awesome.
You know?
All right, let's start wrapping up here. We've been talking for a little over an hour.
Yeah, probably. I'll yap.
No, that's good. That's good. It's easier for me. What is some advice you'd give to, I mean, we kind of already went over it, but besides stay away if you're in it for money.
Yeah, I know that's like a horrible thing to say. I don't want to like turn people away. Like everybody.
No, but that's real.
Everybody should be like hyped on. Like that kid, not that, he's not even a kid, Josh McLuhan. Like I met him down in Florida. I'm probably saying his last name wrong. I'm not mean to. McAwee.
Yeah.
But it was like, I didn't, like this sounds rude, but I didn't know who he was like when he first, until he introduced himself,
right.
You know? But, like, I could tell that, like, he was really, really stoked on photography.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, I was just like, this is awesome. This kid's stoked. Like, it's refreshing to see that. So I don't want to turn people away from that. But it's, like, you got to realize that BMX is an industry where whatever you take, you better be willing to put back into it, whether it's blood, you know, your time, sweat, tears, whatever it is. Like, you have to be passionate about it.
Yeah.
And if you're not passionate about it, a little bit insane, and you just keep pushing,
You're not gonna fit in.
Ever break free or fit in, you know? Like, you have to be willing to do whatever. And the other advice, too, is that kids realize riders are what makes you have a job.
Yeah.
It does coincide a little bit, but you have to realize that, like, at the end of the day, like, I wish I could have somebody to carry a second bag to light my back, but I'm not going to do that. Like, this sounds horrible, but it's not that, like, it's an athlete, but it's like, that's your... Like, this is your job. Their job is to go try all this stuff and push the sport. You have to make it look good for them. So, like, you know, that's the one thing that, like, I don't know. That always irritates me. It's not irritate me, but it's just, like, maybe I'm jealous, but I'm like,
well,
you know.
Shit. You ever try to put yourself in their shoes and, like, literally put your life on the line for one clip, for one photo?
I don't
like,
have two teeth for a reason.
Yeah, that's
you know,
true.
Like, that's the whole thing. I broke my jaw. Like,
yeah.
I broke my jaw filming something.
Really?
Yeah, it was just a 5-foot hip into an 8-foot hip, and I landed it perfectly fine the way it should have been, all nose dipped, and it was sandy at the top of the coping, and game over, you know?
Oh,
but it's like,
fuck.
So I do know how, you know, I never rode at like the dude's levels that I'm shooting at.
Yeah.
But I've watched like so much frustration and like pain and like.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that our frustration and pain on our backs from our photo bags
that's not
pales
shit.
In comparison to what they're actually
that's
going
not
through.
Shit.
Yeah.
Like, I just watched Colin spend a week on the couch with a hurt ankle while all of us rode nonstop, ice on and off stretches. Like, I don't think it's important for people to appreciate that and appreciate the rider. Like, you know, you have to understand that, like, you can't put extra pressure and force them too much.
No.
I did that to JJ once, but that was, he was being a bitch and he knows that. And that was like 5 years ago. And he'll tell you that he was. Like, he had already overgrinded this rail. And I basically was like, dude, come on. Like, you said you were going to do it. Like, I'm not being an asshole, but, you know, I feel like that's a real weird scenario. Like, I don't ask for people to do stuff again. I do get lucky sometimes.
Yeah.
Like, you know, sometimes with certain things, like, there's one or two photos I've shot where I accidentally got the bar, like, the littlest bit past 90, and luckily, God bless, you know, the Fiend dude's like, oh, well, let me try it. If I get it, cool. If not, I do like the photo, but, you know, and it's like, don't you think it'd be better just all the way back? Yeah, of course.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, of course it is.
The gold
but,
standard of barspins.
Yeah, I hate barspins. I don't know. I don't hate
barspins, dude.
Some people's are easier than others. JJ's got the easiest barspins in the world.
What's up with his?
They're slow. He leans back and he underhands, over exaggerates.
Damn. Okay, Stevie, if you ever shot a barspin?
Does he wrap around?
No, he hunches up his shoulders. And as soon as he hunches his shoulders, he whips them fast as fuck. And as soon as I see his shoulders reach
that's
peak
when you
elevation,
have to shoot it.
Click, and you'll have it. You'll have it 6 o'clock every time. It's awesome.
It's
depending
weird
on
how
camera,
like you learn different stuff like that.
It's great.
Like, I don't know. I think somebody mentioned on another one of your podcasts, like the whole doing it on the ground thing.
Yeah.
Like just, now with those four dudes, like I've shot enough bar spins that for the most part, but. I missed a bar spin I missed a warm-up bar spin medium format, and I swear to God that should never happen because there's no lag time on a Bronica. When you hit the shutter, you hit the shutter. So, like, when the warm-up shot came out of that roll, I was just like, What's wrong with me, you know?
There's an off day.
That shouldn't happen.
Yeah,
you know?
No, sometimes there's just off days.
But it does sometimes, you know? Yeah, there definitely is. Yeah, work to push them.
Yeah, yes. Even same with riding. I feel like there are days where I can ride better than others. There's days I can film better than others. And there's days where I can shoot better photos than
exactly.
others, you know? And you have to just, like, really milk that, you know?
Yep.
I don't know. Tuesday, the most productive day of my work week is a Tuesday. And
really?
I have this little theory that it's whatever day of the week you were born on is your most productive day during the week.
I don't even know what day I was
born on. Although I did hear that Tuesday is like socially accepted as the most productive day of the week for a couple of reasons. Right? Monday's Wednesday's like hump day, and Thursday's like, oh, we're almost to the weekend. Friday, no one does shit. So Tuesday's just there where people are actually doing work.
Yeah, I guess that is
true. And I heard that, and I sort of adopted it, and it's seriously true. And well, for me at least.
Yeah.
And then I talked to someone who was born on a Sunday, and they said Sunday was their most productive day of the week.
I hope mine's Saturday or Sunday. Imagine if it's on the weekend, because the weekends are the best. Like,
yeah.
My Saturdays.
With riding at least.
Yeah, and my Saturdays are like my Mondays. Like, that's going to start. And then, so, you know, you're around all the dudes that are on the team. They're going to come up with random ideas while they're out. So then you got your Mondays where it's like my Monday, Tuesday, Wednesdays are my busy days. And then Thursday, Friday are more like, you know, well, I deal with Taiwan a lot, and Taiwan's not open on Friday. So Friday's like, let's go to the beach, let's go ride. You know, it's a lot more open,
yeah,
at least for me.
I never thought of it that way. That's kind of funny.
Yeah.
Saturday is the Monday. Yeah, because when, I mean, it's open season in Southern California. For
wait
any
until,
schoolyard.
Wait
dude.
Until you have to explain that to a girl.
Why do you say that?
Oh, I can't go out and drink Friday. Saturday is my Monday. And it's
yeah.
like, what do you mean? Oh, I'm going to be shooting photos in a schoolyard all day. You know, like.
No, I always, like, see just normal people doing their normal weekend things, like bar hopping or, like, going to the beach. Or
brunch,
like,
dude. Brunch is
brunch
the
is
shit.
The thing.
Dude,
Southern
down by
brunches.
Me in San Diego, it's a fucking yuppie. Like,
God, every time I saw that.
I don't know. I understand the brunch thing. Like, I love to eat, and I love mimosas, whatever they're called.
Staying up all night and not eating breakfast.
See, like, that's
one.
The thing. Like, I party more on a Monday night than I will any other night.
True.
I don't really party that often, but, you know, like, there's would be more of a chance of me going to a bar with all the friends on a Monday night than on a Friday or Saturday night, because I love BMX, and I would rather wake up early and feel good about shooting photos. I'm really weird about mornings. I have to have, like, an hour to myself. Like, just one of those people. I got to do my shit. I got to make my coffee. I have to look at my emails. I have to check stupid Instagram shit, you know? But
would you ever give up the whole BMX lifestyle for a normal 9-to-5?
No, dude. You want to know the honest truth?
Yes.
I took a Lyft test drive yesterday. And the only reason I did it, or a test drive to become a Lyft driver,
right,
is because it's like, dude, I want to do more, and I don't want to take any more from BMX. Like,
okay,
you know,
I like,
like
what you're saying there. Yeah,
you know, so it's like, okay, so
if you're not gonna find the money here, don't try to get it. Don't squeeze it out. Somewhere.
Exactly. So it's like, okay, so fuck it. Like at 10 o'clock at night, instead of just sitting on the couch or like, you know, whatever I'm doing, I can go drive for a couple, hopefully, I don't know, I haven't started yet, hopefully drive for a couple hours and put more money in my gas tank, and
hell yeah.
You know, I think it's going to be real sick for finding spots, like,
oh, totally.
Just think of all the, and then all the random people.
Yeah.
That's the new podcast idea.
You should probably have, like, a GoPro on the back of your car
That's what,
or something.
Yeah, I was talking to Ennis about that, like, it would just be sick to do a podcast where you just record the sound,
yeah,
and you don't tell them, and you just cut it up.
That's illegal. I'm pretty
sure.
Yeah,
it definitely is. But if
you had a sign conspicuously posted saying you were being recorded, which is probably
lots of people probably
for a Lyft or
anytime.
Uber.
But anytime, how often do you? Most of the times, I take a Lyft. I had too much to drink,
right.
Unless my car's broke down or something like that. But so most of the time, it's like you're gonna say crazy
yeah,
stuff
you don't
anyway.
Care.
Like I know I've said some like real ridiculous stuff in like Lyft drives. You know,
that's funny.
But I don't know. Back on like the what you were asking about people coming up, I just think that like really for the longevity of it. And sad to say, I think people need to stop worrying about images just being in Ride UK, or not Ride UK, in print media.
Right.
You know, I mean, I think at this point, at least for me, I've had to bite the bullet, like, mentally. You know, like, I'm sitting on some photos right now that, for one reason or another, it isn't the photo, it's not the rider, it comes down to dollars, which I understand everyone has to get paid, and I want my friends to eat good as good as they can, you know, so... But I think you have to look at how many people see it. You know, just the likes on Instagram isn't how many people see it.
Right.
Like, there's a way to have a longevity, or not a longevity, like it is somewhat forgotten about, but there is other outlets. Don't just get caught up on getting an image in a magazine.
Yeah.
Like, kids don't know this, but it's going to buy you a really good steak dinner. You can take your girlfriend out, and you can have a real good dinner, but it's not going to make or break your rent.
No.
And people will see your work. Period. No matter if it's good and it speaks for yourself, people will see it. You know, like 90% of my images end up on Instagram.
90?
I would not even that. Or on my hard drive. I've got, I sit on a lot.
Shoot, I'm 2% of my photos are on Instagram.
But I'm saying Instagram. You're saying 2%?
Dude, I don't put anything on Instagram.
Why not? What are you scared of?
I just want it to be seen in a different... I want it to be seen larger. My goal is for my photos to be seen as large as possible first, and then work my way down to Instagram.
And that weeds out what people are doing and what people aren't doing.
Exactly.
Like, as photographers, we all know if something's in focus on Instagram or not. But
that's... Okay,
I can
tell. Let me tell you...
I can tell.
Every photo I shoot that's not in focus at all... Instagram. You
really?
Can't tell. There's this one photo.
You can't tell. Look at the noise around the spokes and around the bars and stuff. You can see a little noise.
All right, I'll show you after this. I'll show you the photo. You tell me if it's.
I've only got one that I intentionally.
Wait, you jacked up the sharpness and all that.
What on the one that's
on the one that's
left?
Out of focus?
I don't touch sharpness. That adds noise.
Okay.
Oh, I would rather have it be soft than add noise. Like it just. I don't know. I just the noise hasn't figured itself out. Noise should start hopefully transferring into more of grain than noise, and I think it slowly have. Like, the 72 has noise, but it's not nearly the same noise that the regular 70 do.
The fucking rainbow-colored golf balls.
Dude. Yeah.
Yeah, but, no, they're working it out. And honestly, with the fucking the Sony Alpha 7, they can shoot at 128,000 ISO. I haven't pixel-picked that one yet, but I'm sure it's pretty crazy-looking.
I try not to, I admittedly try not to look at too many people other photos. Like,
yeah.
I do, but I feel like with anything, if you look at other people's stuff, you're going to naturally become that person.
Yeah.
So it's like you got to look at it and appreciate it.
Separate yourself.
But don't try to sit there and emulate exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, we all did it. Like, I watched Alecki Z, especially Papiro and Demos for years, you know, mm-hmm. and Fudger, you know. So it's like we all do it to some degree, but I think it's best to
you got to find your own style
a little bit slowly.
You'll get hired because of your own personal style.
Oh, for sure. You definitely will. You know, at the end of the day, it's easier to see someone on Instagram.
Yeah.
So I used to get really bummed out on it. Like I actually had a full blown argument where I was actually pretty much out of line at the time, calling somebody out, I don't want my photos to stand up on Instagram, blah, 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 ranting and raving, I'd rather do it on a website, you know, no, hold them, we'll just wait, you know, and it's then, you know, that kind of happened with a bunch of the Fiend photos that kind of happened with, because there's not if you don't advertise, if the main company you work for, the riders for, doesn't advertise, there's a whole lot less chance that the photos are going to get run. Not even get paid, getting paid is no issue, but there's a less chance that they're going to run an article. Or they're going to run that, which makes sense. You know, you got to cater to advertisements to a degree. Yeah. But in that case scenario, it's like, if it's not going in print, why not let people see it?
That's true. It's just like I said, the thing I hate is it's so small.
There's no,
so
it definitely is.
So many intricacies going on. Like, there's this one photo, this dude, I totally forget his name. But I just emailed him, yesterday about this photo that he had on his Instagram where the rider is literally a dot in the frame.
See.
And I was like, dude, send me that JPEG. I'll put it on the website. Like, people need to see how much is going on in here. You know, you're really selling yourself short by putting it in.
And that's definitely true. But at the same time, I know, so say I'm sitting on 10 photos right now. Okay, so sitting on 10 photos, one or two of those are going to get sold for an ad for another company that a rider rides for, I'm sure, at some point.
Mm-hmm.
The rest might end up on Instagram. They might end up on Dig. Who knows, you know? But it's at some point, I just want them seen.
Yeah.
I just want them seen.
Well, that's
the thing.
How long do you sit on photos for until you just say fuck it and get rid of them? Jesus. Well, not get rid of, but what's your last resort output? My last resort output is Instagram.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
My last resort option is Instagram. But it also, with me, it's different because I don't, Fiend pays me to do a job. It's photography and some other stuff, you know, mm-hmm. A lot of communication stuff. But so I have to keep them in best interest as well,
mm-hmm.
which is fine with me. But sometimes it is best to put on Instagram. During Fiending, I'll admit in my sick little fucked up of a mind, it's dude, I'm about to drop an uprail fucking hard truck on Instagram. Let's see what happens. And then it's entertaining because kids like Jeff Z, I still remember he commented oh, blah, blah, blah. And it's that's awesome.
Yeah.
That three table, I never would have wanted that on Instagram either. But just because it's that, you get to hear back in the comments what people think about it. And with something like the three table, I think Instagram was ultimately a good place for it.
Okay.
Because it's a three table down a set of stairs. Like, it doesn't really...
A really good three table, though.
Yeah. But you know what I'm saying. So it's like, it's a three table down a set of stairs, so it's something that's going to stir a conversation.
Yeah.
And I think that's nice as a photographer, not to even hear it back, but just to know that, like, people were talking about either the... not even the photo, just the trick, the fact that it happened, like, this second in time between me and my friends, like, you know, like, it's awesome that, like, kids are even interested in that, and it's, in a sense, I guess I've been able to find that rewarding.
I'm, like, rethinking my whole life right now.
Put them on Instagram. No, don't dump them on Instagram. I've got so much crap on my phone I could just dump right now, but I never would.
You know what I'm picturing right now is everyone at the palace sitting in the couches, semi-circle around the table, and there's a copy of, like, Ride BMX on the table, and everyone just sitting back on Instagram.
It happens, dude.
Yeah, it does.
It really does happen. Yeah. Like, I can't count how many times, like, I've been in the van, and we're heading somewhere, and so, like, did you see Alex just did this? Like,
yeah.
Frank just dropped that photo, like...
13 seconds of...
That's nuts, and yeah. I'm like... And then I'm, like, emailing Frank, like, yo, it's fire, like, dude, like, you're, you know, like, I'm a big Frank fan, I just think he's an awesome dude in general, so it's like... You know, I'll be like, you know, it's just, and you got these dudes, your peers that you ride with or other fellow pro riders.
Yeah.
And they're admiring your stuff when they should be partying in a van on the way to a trip, you know, or whatever.
Shit, man. That might be the future.
I hope it's not.
Yeah. It's just the whole size thing, dude. I wish at least, I mean, but no, we can't carry around laptops in our pockets. It's all convenient.
No, it's not. It's you can't. And it is, unfortunately, we live in a convenient world. And like I said, the only way I see the, like, printing being saved is if photographers are willing to give away their photos and do something together to just put it back to BMX. Like, even like I said, if it is a $10 or $15 book, like, there's ways around it. Like, we just as photographers have to find it because, I mean, you know, I want to see my stuff in print, but I'm not going to cry that it's not in Ride, you know, or it's not in BMX Plus.
Wait, but let's get back to it. What's the oldest photo you're sitting on? How long ago did you shoot it?
Dude, if we're talking I've got stuff that's a year old plus that hasn't been out yet.
Actually, like cutting edge action photos?
Yeah, a year.
Okay. What about just like lifestyle, 35 millimeter portrait stuff?
Boxes.
Yeah.
Boxes full of it.
Yeah, I was just thinking that.
Black and white and 35 and just lifestyle stuff?
Yeah.
Like stuff that there's like moments on road trips that can't ever be shown in light. Not that like anybody's a bad person or anything, but like you don't put like a photo of Ty drinking a beer, having a good time, cheers and Tony on Instagram 35. Like it's just like I'm selfish. That's for me and my homies to see in five years, you know?
It's too timeless.
So that stuff a lot. But action photos, like, dude, there was a point where I was sitting on something for close to two years.
See, and that's when it becomes a problem because that trick will become outdated or it'll get one-upped. But
you never know, though. It's a risk, but that's the same risk that the rider's taking. So then again, don't be selfish. The rider hasn't put the clip out yet.
No, I'm on your side with this. I'm on your side with this, too. And I was just thinking about how I have this pretty crazy photo shot in here with a couple people who are rarely ever together.
Yeah.
And I'm just thinking in my head, like, I'm waiting a good 5, maybe 10 years to put this out.
Sometimes you have to. I definitely have stuff that, like, I have stuff of the first day I rode with JJ, I probably shot, like, 15 photos.
Yeah.
10 of them have never been seen. And, like, me and him will laugh about him sometimes. I'll, like, send him a picture, and he's like, I'm such a fat ass in that, you know? And I'm like, yo, I was big then, too. I didn't get on the Cali weight program, you know, yet on that either. But it's, like, I don't know. Sometimes what's the value... You know, there's some stuff you just want people to see. Like, realistically, the action stuff and the real crazy stuff, I hold less personal value to than anything. To me, it's a little bit less because I thank all the dudes from Fiend. They all individually support me in their own way, and Fiend for being able to support me to be able to just shoot photos with those dudes.
Yeah.
So, like, for me, it's a little bit less business because it's like I'm not worried about going home and selling it.
Right.
And don't ever do that to a rider, people. It's happened where people pull a trick
and then
people
know when
they're guilty. You don't send the photo and make money on it without the rider seeing it or the clip coming out.
I'm going to say...
And the people that have done it know who they are. Don't do that shit. It's fucking rude.
Oh, man, I remember the one story. I'm not even going to say it, though. Let's wrap up.
All right.
I think we did pretty well here. Right. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you. Glad
hopefully,
to come out.
We'll have, like, we could just do another interview maybe in a year and see how things have changed.
Sounds
just
good.
Catch up on this one.
I hope they don't. Every day should be Groundhog's Day. I'm not complaining.
Hell yeah. Kevin Connors, follow your heart. subscribe to a print magazine. Have a good day.
That's it.